pressure for men and women to look perfect has never been more intense. Nearly every one of us is affected by the issue, either directly or through people we know. And today we're putting the subject of body image under the microscope with our forum of experts. We have international plus-sized model, Sophie Sheppard, Rachael Mannell, former beauty director of Cleo Magazine and a presenter on the Healthy Me TV network, Tony Kay, who is a recovering anorexic, psychologist Sarah McMahon, who is director of the Body Matters Clinic, Dr. James Southwell-Keely, a plastic and corrective surgeon, and Studio 10 producers Carolyn Rooney and Tori Green, who are both getting ready to go under the... I didn't read this. Yeah. What? Yeah. You're going under the knife?
I was shocked as well, but
we will get to that. These girls are like my kid sisters. They'll be getting a talking to after the show.
Yeah, they'll be going under the back of your hand before they go under that.
Sophie, we'll start with you. You're obviously a hugely successful model, but how much pressure was there on you, I suppose, when you first started out to be one of the skinnier ones?
I actually was really fortunate that I never had that pressure. I started as a plus model, which in fashion is anything from a size 10 up, pretty much. So for me, I haven't really had that pressure. It's great. It's a really broad spectrum. But for the girls who are the straight size, which is typically 6 and 8, I think there is huge amounts of pressure for them to be and keep at those certain measurements to fit into the samples.
Hmm. Because, Rachael, you used to be a beauty director at Cleo. Yes. Why do you think we don't feature, I suppose, plus-size models enough? Often it's almost done like a bit of a gimmick, really, as opposed to let's just see it every day in the pages.
Look, unfortunately, it's actually usually commerce. When you're on a fashion shoot, you have, 8 hours, maybe, to do 10 outfits. And I know I'm carrying a tiny bit of weight. I've had a baby, so when I dress, I try and dress in a flattering way. They don't have the luxury of doing that. They just need to put the clothes on. They have sample sizes. They need to show as much as they can. And if it's a plus-size model, that the fashion editor or the fashion assistant, who's usually under the pump, that's how it is in magazines, and they would have to go and source all sorts of different clothes, there's not enough time. So they can't be worrying about what's flattering. They just need to show the clothes and they need to, you know, get that magazine spread out.
Isn't it also the case, though, where there was a German magazine that said, all right, we're not going to show these unrealistic, you know, celebrities or models or whatever. We're just going to show real people, all very noble and everything. And it folded almost before it was launched because people, you know, if they want to see normal-looking people, they can walk out the front door and people actually buy magazines to see ridiculously attractive people. Is that right?
That's right. I mean, maybe not even ridiculously attractive people, but it needs to be aspirational. I mean, if a man wants to get fit, he's going to look at, you know, our sports stars with, you know, a beautiful physique as someone that he wants to emulate. So it's not... It's a tricky thing. I know as a beauty director, I would always try and... I was never a cookie-cutter approach. I'd try and get people to enhance what they have. I don't think it's about massive transformations. And I don't think magazines are really guiding people to transform their life. They're trying to get them to improve it.
Tony, if I can just interrupt there. Yes. Thank you very much. Tony, you're a recovering anorexic.
Yes.
Were you influenced by images and you know, fashion to lose the weight you did?
I think there's definitely... there's definitely an expectation that's projected by those magazines that if you don't look this way, there's something wrong with you.
But did you read those magazines? You wouldn't have been reading girly magazines.
I didn't personally look to those magazines, but they're definitely out there and they're definitely something that kind of are in your peripheral vision when you're...
What do you think pushed you?
I can't say that there's any one particular thing. I know there's underlying issues and from, I guess I could say, most anorexics, there's your anorexia is... a reflection of something that's deeper going on for you. It's just a manifestation. It's a coping mechanism. I could have turned to drugs. I could have turned to alcohol. I happened to just develop an eating disorder to deal with whatever was going on for me inside. But I know that when I've tried to get fit, I've always looked to or been exposed to those magazines or TV or just pretty much anything in the media in general. It would project an image of this is what masculine males look like, this is what a man looks like, and this is what fit looks like if you don't look this way. And these are kind of, I guess, sort of the stereotype for what success looks like, what desirable looks like, what, you know, if you're this way, then life will be better, you'll be happier. And that if I didn't look that way, then there was something wrong with me and I needed to strive to this unrealistic expectation. And we mentioned before about, you know, you look to sort of sports stars and people that you sort of maybe idolise in the media or in the sporting world. A lot of those things are functional. You know, a sports star looks the way he does because he needs to be that strong, that fast, that fit. You know, fit for a normal person can just be a health thing. It can be going to the gym a couple of times a week just to be, you have a general sense of fitness within yourself. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have to look like an Adonis.
Can we bring Sarah from the Body Matters Clinic in? It's so interesting because we do get caught up with how this affects young women, but obviously men are slipping through the cracks as well, young men, and the whole issue of body image.
Absolutely, and I completely agree with what Tony's just said. You know, we can't blame the media exclusively. People don't wake up and decide to get an eating disorder. There's a whole complex factor of risk factors which lead someone down that path. But the thing that I think is really important for us to talk about and to note is that dieting is the biggest risk factor. So most people who develop an eating disorder often will talk about the fact that they just started on an innocent diet and it went terribly wrong. And this has been really well documented in scientific research, that there's a whole heap of behavioural and physiological effects which happen with some people when they do lose weight, which means that some people do end up developing a clinical eating disorder.
All right. We have to take a very quick break, but when we come back, we are asking whether a boob job or a nose job, which one you would take, and why two of our panellists actually want to go under the knife to get plastic surgery. Studio 10, we'll be right back. We're going to continue with our body image forum now, and from diets to eating disorders to plastic surgery, it's an issue that really does affect us all. Now, we're going to talk to two young women who are about to go under the knife. They're actually very good friends of mine, and they are Studio 10 producers, Carolyn Rooney and Tori Green. Kaz, I'll start with you. What are you going to get done?
I want to get nose job. So I've never really been very happy with my nose. When I was younger, I broke it, and I never really had it fixed. So sort of corrective, sort of cosmetic. I want to get a bit off it, get the tip less bulbous, and make it straight, basically, because at the moment, if I see a picture of myself, I just focus straight on the nose, so I'm just not happy with it.
Barbara Streisand made a fortune having a great nose, as well as a great voice. Have you thought about that?
I have, and we should speak to our exec producer and get a little pay rise, but no. it's not really something that... It's not like I'm not confident or it's not that I think I can make some money with it or anything like that. It's something that I look at myself and I just focus on it, and I don't want to. I just want to just look like normal, really, and just be happy with my face. And I feel like if you're not happy with something, why wouldn't you change it in any aspect of your life? If you weren't happy with something, you change it. And if I can, then I will.
And Kaz, I mean, looking at you, you're beautiful. You're absolutely gorgeous. Lots of people would say, why on earth would you want to fiddle with your nose?
Yeah.
Is it something that over time it's worried you or concerned you more, or you always sort of thought this is something I do want to change?
No, when I was younger, I probably had more of an issue with it. I wouldn't have a profile picture taken. Mm-hmm. I would absolutely I'd always pose the right way. Mm. And as I've gotten older, I've gotten more confident and not worried about it so much. But I've also earned more money and can now save up for a nose job. So I just think I may as well just get it done. I don't really see a problem with people trying to improve themselves. Yep.
Tori Green, speak to me. What do you want to get done?
Well, I've always been quite self-conscious about my breasts, so I've wanted to get a breast augmentation. Not so much in terms of sizing. I'm not too bothered about, you know, having the huge boobs, and I find, you know, the bolt-ons are that very plasticky look. But I've always been uncomfortable with them. I've never really taken my top off during, like, even with boyfriends. My mum has never seen my boobs past, you know, the age of when I was younger, running around topless at the beach. So, you know, I find, and the same with Kaz, if you're not happy unhappy with something and you look every day in the mirror and it's such a big focus for you, why not change it? And when you have the ability to do so, I think
you're breathing notes. Like sorry. Them? Your boobs.
You go.
Yeah, why don't you like your boobs? I mean,
Jess and I, we've barely got a cut between us.
And it's like it's never been about size for me. I mean, I'm fine with size, but I do have, as most women do, I have uneven breasts. So my right one is smaller than my left one. And I've just, for some reason, I've just never been comfortable with it. And I don't, there's nothing really I can explain as to why I'm not comfortable with it, but it's always eaten away at me. You know, getting out of the shower every day and I look at myself in the mirror, getting ready for work, and it's just something they'll have a concern of. I'm not getting it so I can wear tight tops. I don't wear tight tops. I've always worn loose-fitting clothing like that. It's not about having the huge boobs and the cleavage and that sexiness about
the jobs. You're a very beautiful young girl. You're a very beautiful young girl. And in your briefing note, you said you thought it would give you more confidence. I'm not sure that boobs are things that give us confidence, but I understand if you don't like the way you look that that might make you feel less confident, but actually sometimes because you're a young beautiful woman you haven't quite got the confidence you're probably looking for.
Yeah, I think the confidence doesn't come down to having breasts. It's about feeling comfortable. And I think of like if I was able to correct something that I'm unhappy with, similar with cats, I mean, I have the ability to do so. So why wouldn't I want to feel confident and comfortable in my own skin? So I think that's where I'd go with it.
Big decision.
Yeah, it is.
It's a big decision.
It's major surgery we're talking about here. Let's bring in James, our plastic surgeon. Are you seeing more of this these days? Women wanting to, well, young women in particular, really smart young women wanting to kind of undergo this huge surgery?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, these two young ladies are very typical of the sort of patients you see. They're motivated, they're articulate, they know what they want. You're not fishing around in the dark trying to work out if you're speaking the same language even. They're very articulate. They can tell you exactly what it is that they'd like attended to. And I think they make wonderful patients.
James, do you find that a lot of the girls or even the guys that come in and ask for, say, augmentation or that they get the nose job, do they ever come back with any bad feedback where they're shocked because they now look completely different?
Look, that's part of the consultative process where you really, it's an education for both patient and for surgeon. For me to understand that we're both on the same page and for the patient to understand what is physically and technically possible. And if you can arrive at the same point, then you can move forward together. If you don't arrive at that same point, then you can't progress forward.
So do you have ask another question, but do you have a certain amount of time, like a decision process, to give them a bit of opportunity to soak it up? So pictures to show what they might look like, to give them, I guess, a bit more time rather than it being a knee-jerk reaction?
Absolutely. No, it should never be a knee-jerk reaction. All of my consultations that have a cosmetic component are replicated, so you'll see me at least twice. And if I think there's any ambiguity, either for myself or for the patient, we see each other as many times as it takes until we reach that common endpoint, or I just have to refer them on to someone else.
Yeah, because there's a big psychological kind of issue at play. Have you ever refused somebody who has wanted to undergo the knife so badly, but it's obviously for, not saying that you girls are, but there are certainly people who you know don't have that lack of confidence because of mental health issues or psychological factors.
Yeah, so there's a common subgroup of patients who have a body dysmorphic disorder, and you'll never make them happy. I'll never make them happy. They'll never be happy with anything that a surgeon can do, be that myself or anyone else. And they're best educated and referred on to help with other people, such as Sarah, psychiatrists. You draw upon all avenues of help for these patients, but you don't operate on them. Mm. It's just sadness for everyone.
Mm. Well, Kaz and Tori, you are both very smart girls, and I'm sure whatever decision you make will be the right one, but as your fairy godmothers here, we say no.
But
you're beautiful as it is.
But Sarah, if they do have the operation, naturally we'll be having you on the couch here to tell us all about it.
Thank you so much. We really appreciate it. It's been really interesting to talk to you about all of this.